thank you for watching this special presentation about the Little Red Schoolhouse. You know, many people are responsible for preserving this historic landmark for future generations. We especially appreciate the many contributions of our retired educators. While our classrooms today are certainly in stark contrast to the Little Red Schoolhouse, one thing remains the same. A caring teacher who loves children is a key to learning. As we look to the future, let us never forget the past. Let's remember our heritage, a legacy that comes to life in a Little Red Schoolhouse.
The heritage of Baldwin County Public Schools is a story that's more than 200 years old. Throughout Baldwin County, communities cared so much about the education of their children that families got together and built buildings, a real place, a real school, so their children could have an education. In fact, at the turn of the century, the 20th century, at one time there were more than 90 community schools in Baldwin County. Families would get together, build a school, and then once they had shown the interest in the school, then the county was able to pay the teacher. There's one school that stands out as an outstanding example of a community education project, and that's the Little Red Schoolhouse. The Little Red Schoolhouse was built by families in the Bromley community on Highway 225 in Baldwin County, Alabama, and it was named the Blakely School. The story begins with Miss Rebecca Burke, who married George Tompkins, and they moved to Highway 225 in Baldwin County, probably for turpentine or lumber business. And this couple had a dream. It was right after World War I in 1920. Members of the community decided to get together and build this wonderful little one-room school for their children. And in 1920, the school was completed with lumber from their fields and their forests, and with sweat and blood and tears from their own hands. This one-room schoolhouse today is a symbol of a community spirit that cares about the future of their children. And the Little Red Schoolhouse story is one that inspires us. It is one that motivates us to give our children better than we had. The Little Red Schoolhouse today stands in Bay Minette as a living history museum, but its story begins in 1920 on Magnolia Church Road in Baldwin County, Alabama. Memories of this school and the stories that these walls tell are precious to those people who were blessed enough to be able to attend school and have their grandmother, their mother, and their aunt, Miss Rebecca Burke Tompkins, teach them. Rebecca was the daughter of a former slave, and she was from Selma, Alabama, and they probably moved here for turpentine business or lumber business. And the dream that they brought with them was to build a school and to provide education for all of their family and the children in the community. So they were leaders to start to build this beautiful little one-room school. The building itself did follow state plans, and the blueprints of that show that they followed it true. As you enter the front door, there's a library on one side and the cloakroom on the other. And the room itself is just like the blueprints show us that we have on hand. Miss Tompkins taught in this school and taught many of her children, grandchildren, nieces, and nephews. And her husband, George, also worked for the county school system. And in fact, he drove a school bus. He converted his truck into a school bus and drove right across Bromley Creek with no bridge to pick up all of the children that weren't close enough to walk to the school. And she taught in that school until about 1950, when the school was closed. That's about the time Douglasville High School opened, and she was transferred to Douglasville High School. And so the Little Red Schoolhouse was standing abandoned on Magnolia Church Road. full of memories of all of the children who had laughed and played and learned within its walls. Former Superintendent Leslie Smith picks up the story from there of how the Little Red Schoolhouse has come to be a precious, precious treasure today.
Well, I first became acquainted with this building when I came to the central office as Supervisor of Buildings and Transportation. It was one of my duties to see that all school property was properly insured. That is, that it was insured for its replacement value. It was required by law. And once a year, a representative from the State Department of Education would come down to Baldwin County, and we would make a tour of the county. And we would visit every single building that was here and make sure that it was properly valued or valued at a reasonable price. And this required that we ensure the abandoned school buildings as well as the regular ones. This particular building was in the community of Bromley. It was off Highway 225 to the east, off the beaten track, out in the woods with the woods grown up all around it. But I had to visit it several times a year to make sure that it was still there. Got some surprises from time to time. I have been telling a story about a little snake that crawled up the inside of this door face, and when I walked in, it was a little rat snake. And another time when I walked in, I found the building was inhabited by a family. A family had just moved into the building. As I learned later, I think there'd been a fire somewhere in the community. But a family just came and took it over. And I didn't know what to do with them. We couldn't let them stay, but we couldn't run them off under those circumstances. And anyway, it finally took care of itself. They just disappeared. I never did know where they went. It again came to my attention when we were looking about for buildings that we could move to campuses to take care of a kindergarten program. In the late 70s, the state of Alabama phased in a kindergarten program throughout the state, and we got additional teacher units, but they gave us no money for school buildings. And we had no excess money and nor any borrowing power at the time. So the only thing we knew how to do was just to go out into these communities where these old abandoned buildings were and bring them in and do what we could for them. And we chose to move this one to White House Forks. I do remember going down and meeting with the trustees of the school a day or two after we moved it in there. It was a sad sight. It hadn't been painted in years, and the exterior was deteriorated, and a lot of boards had fallen off. Matter of fact, we'd taken part of the roof off to move it. It was indeed a sad sight, and those trustees were upset, and they had every reason to be. And I remember promising them that if they would just give me a few weeks, we would make them proud of this school building. And I think we did. It just seemed so much like the Little Red Schoolhouse that we just chose that motive for it and built a little portico that's on the front out there. And then after we got that built, it just had to be a bell up there. And I talked to Mr. Jackson, who was head of the vocational, the building trade department at Robert Stelier Vocational School. He took it on almost as a personal project, and he designed a little cupola and built a wooden bell that's inside. It's a shape of an octagon rather than a round bell, but it's built out of redwood. And the whole thing will be there a long time. He and we hauled it up here in the truck and stuck it on the building. To make a long story short, the people of Crosswoods were proud of it, but they weren't half as proud of it as they were as that young kindergarten teacher was. I remember the first time that I went back to the building after the program had gotten operation. That was that young teacher sitting in a rocking chair that she had brought in, and she had decorated the back of it with a colorful cover over the back and a cushion in it. And she was sitting in that in this rocking chair with all those little kids out in front of her. I had never seen kids that young in school. But it was the most beautiful sight, I think, that I have ever seen. And when that school was discontinued and she was assigned to the new school, she wanted to take that building with us. when Crossroads School was discontinued and consolidated with the new Delta School, there was a lot of competition among schools. Everybody wanted this building. The new teacher wanted to take it with her to Delta, and a half a dozen other organizations wanted it. We had lots of applicants. This was after my time with the Board of Education. I was retired by that time, but there was a great deal of thought given as to what should happen to this building, and I think we made the right decision. I think the board made the right decision to bring it here and set it up as the Little Red Schoolhouse Project, and try to preserve some of the history of our school system and do it in and about this building, and especially make it available to children in the years to come. And that's exactly what we've seen here today.
And thanks to the vision of people like Leslie Smith and Sam Watson, the Little Red Schoolhouse has been preserved. It stands for all of the community schools in Baldwin County in which families came together to provide education for their children, the true meaning of public education. The building itself, located in Bay Minette, Alabama today, is now a living history museum in the sense that when you walk into the doors, you feel what these walls must be telling you. The memories that are here are best recalled by the descendants of the first principal and teacher, Miss Tompkins.
Welcome to the Little Red Schoolhouse. This is the original one-room school built back in the 1920s on Magnolia Church Road in Bromley, Alabama. It's a pleasure for me to stand before you today and share part of my heritage with you. See, my great-grandmother was the original teacher and principal of this Little Red Schoolhouse. And I had the pleasure of sitting down with my grandfather before he passed away and listen at his firsthand account of the origin of this Little Red Schoolhouse. This school was constructed by the African-American community to provide a place for their children to go to a real school. The first teacher and principal was Mrs. Rebecca Burke Tompkins, who was a leader in the community, and this restored school is dedicated to her memory. Her husband drove the school bus, and many of the students were her own children and kinfolk. The heritage she left is honored today in this very building. As seen in an early 1950 photo of the Little Red Schoolhouse, it is noted that there was only a simple platform at the top of the steps, and the roofline remains the same today. The steps lead into an entryway, which is flanked by two small rooms. On the left is the cloakroom and storage closet, and on the right is the library or workroom. Originally, there were double doors connecting the library to the main classroom. The plans call for a platform to be installed at the front of the room for the teacher's desk. The paint was supplied by the state of Alabama in specified colors, research-based to enhance learning, as noted in the publication of the state. The school did not have any indoor restrooms, as did none of the schools of this era, and electric lights were probably added at a later time. Heat was provided by a wood-burning stove that would have had a protected fender around it to prevent children from burns. The flue location shows that the building did follow the state plan. The Little Red Schoolhouse was designed in records as the Blakely School and is sometimes referred to as the Bromley School. It served African American children in grades 1 through 9, for most part taught by Miss Tompkins. There are records that there were two teachers during the 1940s. Mrs. May Watson was listed as a teacher here for several years.
First, let me say that the things that I learned in this setting, in this school, has served as a template for me as far as everyday life is concerned. Let me just expound on that a little bit. When I said it served as a template, we were taught how to get along with people. We were taught how to share, and we had a origin of deep Christian value. We had prayer in the mornings and prayer in the afternoons and so forth. So even though we came from a very religious family, but the educational process didn't deviate from what we were taught and what we believed in. And certainly the things that we learned, it helped me as growing up as a young teenager in college, and also when I started working. Work ethics. You didn't last in Miss Rebecca's classroom without having good work ethics. And by that I mean there was nothing half done. There was no excuse for half done, a lack of effort. Now, if you made a mistake, there were consideration to help you to do it over. But the lack of effort was not acceptable. And certainly that has been a lifelong learning for me as far as an adult. It helped me when I first started working as a classroom teacher in a rural area of Pensacola in the cantonment area. It was a segregated school. There were children there who were similar to the background that I was familiar with. There were grandmothers raising children and aunts raising children, and we would actually go to the homes and pick up children. That was something I was familiar with. And it was just a great lesson to me to have that foundation to be able to carry out my responsibility. So often, youngsters find themselves in colleges and in training that they don't have the really foundation that will help them when the academics fail and they have to rely on instincts or something, other training. Sometimes that causes them to be misguided in what they're trying to do. And fortunately, we had a person that made sure that we were able to rely on skills and certainly the things that we had learned. When I say that that template that we use, that I've used in everyday life, sharing, we didn't have the luxury of everybody had a class book, a book. We had the books that was handed down to us from the other schools. There were a number of students in the class, so everybody didn't have a class, a textbook. So we had to learn how to share. We had to learn how to get along with each other, which is very, very important in life today. We had to make out with the things that we had. I remember oftentimes we'd go out and doing science period. We'd go out in the woods and get leaves and twigs and different kinds of things to do scientific experiments. from those things. We were not able to go in the lab and get equipment to help us in our science project. We had to be creative in doing those things. And I commend my grandmother for doing a whole lot with a little. And we've gotten away from that attitude of using the resources that you have to make the most of it. We've kind of gotten to the point where if it's not there, then the heck with it. But that was not what we came up with. And I believe that the students that was in this setting with my grandmother in this classroom was able to fight the odds of segregation and without and be successful in their endeavor. And we had students that started out that, as we said, you mentioned a few minutes ago, Mr. Cox and certainly Dr. Gardner, which is elevated in the military aspect of it. And we rely on those things that we hold true to be self-evident that you can do what you want to do by trying and giving it your best. One of the things that we often heard from my grandmother, Ms. Rebecca Thompson, do the very best that you can. And if you fail, you don't need to put your head down and say, I could have done, I should have, I would have. But if you've done the very best that you could and you fail, then you know that you do whatever is necessary to regroup and work on that project. The other aspect of it is getting along with people. We don't have a lot of neighborhoods, and I'm sure you've been in neighborhoods where people just don't get along. In cities and government, people just don't get along. But because of the close proximity in the classroom and knowing that we had to share, we were able to learn other individuals' weakness, other individuals' strength, and we didn't look at another individual's weakness as something and criticize it. We count our blessing and our knowledge of what we were able to do, and we put all of these things together and made it work. So we were, it really meant a lot to us. And I, even at this old age, I sit back and think about where I am today and the foundation that I got, that I attribute it to the start and the things that I learned in this Little Red Schoolhouse. Fantastic aspect of it. We hear teachers complaining about the number of students in my class, and I don't have time to do this, and I don't have time to do that. Rightfully so. But here is a one person served as the principal, the classroom teacher, the janitor to a certain extent, a mother, a nurse, and a guidance counselor for all of the children, all of the grades in that classroom. That is an awesome, awesome person to be able to do that. And certainly, we feel like majority of the children were successful and went on to other heights in high school and graduated from high school. And it has been, I look back over it many, many times and just marvel at the job that was done. So much with so little. And certainly we have to take that kind of attitude and those kind of wits to make sure that we are successful in life. I see too much of children now, the first time that there is a problem, they give up. And I always remember hearing my grandmother tell the parents when they would come for a parents' conference or talking, don't tell your children what they can't be. Don't make comparison of the other siblings. And don't say you're going to be no good just like your daddy or so forth. Because there's no incentive when they have a difficulty, when they fall down, They're only saying, well, I'm doing just what she said I'm going to do. But she taught us that regardless of what the circumstances are, you pick yourself up by your bootstraps and you get up and you try it again and you give it your best, and things will work out. Things just don't happen. I tell groups that I speak to now that things just don't. Successful entrepreneurs and business people and what have you, these things just don't happen. It comes from dedication, hard work, and preparation. I speak to children groups at different times, and I talk about goals, setting goals, preparation, determination, and coping with success. And these are the things that I learned in these four walls, many, many more years than I like to think about. And when we talk about setting goals, then you got to be prepared. If you want to be an astronaut, a pharmacist, a doctor, a lawyer, you have to be prepared to do these things. And secondly, you have to be determined, because you know as well as I do, there are going to be times when in the process of you trying to get certified, there are going to be all kinds of obstacles. That's going to be if it's finance, personal problems, and so forth. But if you're determined, then you will override those things and continue to do it. And then the last one I talk to them about is coping with success. And I point out to them the athletes, politicians, preachers, and so forth have get there and make it to that pinnacle, and then not being able to cope with the success, they find themselves in a situation where all of that is for naught. So the other three is null and void: your determination, your preparation, and then you get there and not being able to cope with success. And my grandmother wouldn't let you get the big head. If you made an A, she didn't want you pounding your chest. She'd say, isn't that what you're here for? You know, so don't expect any big accolades, because you're only doing what you're here for. And she didn't believe in giving you a quarter, giving you a dollar for an A. That's part of what's expected of you. I hear parents and hear people say, my grandchild made all A's, and I gave her a dollar, I gave her $2. The reward should be that I accomplished what I set out to be, not that I got paid for doing something that you are already paying for me to do. And certainly those are some life skills that I learned as an older man, that from my grandmother. That's another paradigm to this. I knew that she believed in the quality of education, but personally that was my grandmother. So she had more than just one thing to be concerned about us. These were her offsprings, and she wanted them to be successful. And she knew the importance of those things for us to be successful. It was not a case where there's a student, Johnny, I did all I could do for him, and he or she was not successful, and you know, there something happened to him. It was personal to her that her grandchild was not going to be successful. So I think she gave us an extra swat or two with a switch because she didn't want us to fail. I can remember very vividly standing to a board doing timetables, and you didn't sit down until we went through 1 through 10 or the 12 through timetables, and you held your breath sitting in one of these chairs wondering if you were going to be the one that she called on. And if she assigned 5 spelling words and she said, I'm only going to call on one of you per word, but you don't know which word that I'm going to call on, so it behooves you to know all of them. And it was quite an experience. I cherish it to this day. And it served as a foundation for what I am and who I am today. I was a classroom teacher, assistant principal at Pensacola High School, principal of 2 different middle schools. My last 13 years I served as an assistant superintendent and a deputy superintendent. But all of those things I attribute it to the foundation that I got in this building under the auspices and the leadership of Ms. Rebecca Thompson. And I thank God that I, they say you can choose your friends, but you can't choose your relatives. And that's a situation where I'm glad I didn't have that choice, because I make some bad choices at time, and I might have missed the opportunity to be in the family of Rebecca and George Thompson. And you know, George was a bus driver, so we had it from both ends. There was no skipping school, because he picked us up at the house, and if we were not there, his daughters knew that their children was not at school. So we kind of had it, someone might say kind of had it tough, but as I look back over it and have been exposed to things that could have happened, that happened to other people that didn't have that built-in shelter, I feel very blessed to have been a part of that, and I thank God for that opportunity to have that experience. We had the responsibility of getting the wood for the stove, and you were assigned to get two different kinds of what you might not be familiar with. We call it kindling. That's the lighter, what you start the fire with. And then you had the oak wood that once you got it burning going, then you would put that wood in there. At this particular day, I had the responsibility of getting the starter wood. Well, for some reason, I got my responsibilities mixed up with the other person. So we come in there, both of us have the oak wood, and nobody had the starter wood. So my grandmother said politely, "Well, I just guess I'll have to beat one of you until we start a spark." You know, so you know, that was frightening there. You know, so from that time on, I assure you that there were no doubting as to your responsibility as the wood that you were supposed to get, the starter or the regular wood. And she had that stern look, and there was a switch in the corner, stood about 6 feet tall, and it had a way of wrapping itself around you pretty good and and leave a mark there that let you know that it was there. Of course, it was not abuse. It was just recognition of responsibility.
This was where I started the school in 1943, and I attended there, and it was my first formal education. Our parents gave us some help, but they didn't have the material, didn't have the knowledge and skill to do what parents are capable of doing today. But through it all, we were trained. We knew we had to go to school. Now, this little building here is set about a block and a half from my house, so I had to walk to school. But I was one of the closest ones to the school. And would you believe it or not, there were kids that had to walk 3-4 miles to school and back home. There wasn't no parent to come up to get them. And they were gonna be there on time. And that used to be a bad thing, because sometimes we were living right down the hill and they would beat us there. But we were there. I mean, we know we had to be there because that was Grandmother Tompkin, teacher, as Jerome said, principal, janitor, a wonderful person who loved all the kids, knew the family. She knew each kid's, probably when they were born, their nickname, their parents, their nicknames, and just knew all about it. So it was something personal to her. Ms. Tompkin was, like I say, my grandmother, and I was the oldest of all the grandchildren. And I caught it. I really caught it. It wasn't no such thing as being absent, because she called a roll, and you better say present, because she knew, you know, if you're sick, she's going to know everything about you. And she was grateful. She was a person who persisted. She pushed the county. But the Thobbs was the superintendent at that particular time. And she wasn't really afraid to push Mr. Thobbs. She said it in her nice way, but she didn't do a lot of smiling. She was sincere and looked anyone straight in the eye. Talk about the hot lunches. Mrs. Tompkins was responsible for us having a hot lunch. And we used to bring our lunch in little bags, you know, and we'd be thankful if we had two sandwiches in a bag. That was great. And he used the peanut butter and the jelly sandwich, our combination. But she got her husband, George Tompkins, to donate some lumber. He had a lot of timber, land. He was the landowner. That timber cut it from the mill, and it was not finished, but it rough material. But they volunteered and they paid someone a few dollars, and they constructed a cafeteria. The government supplied then powdered egg, powdered milk, a lot of cheese, a lot of commodities, and we only had to purchase just a small amount of goods. And we were able to get that thing free, you know, free. So when we talk about the free lunch, you know, we say that's something new, it's something new, and the hot lunches and what have you. But she wanted to each kid to have a hot lunch. And this came true, a reality. But we didn't have any, we had long benches. You had to share, Jerome talked about sharing. You had to share space, you had to share everything. And one thing she didn't want you doing is sharing your food, because she said, if you're not going to eat it, then you need to eat your own food. So that's one of the persistent side of her. And Coach Grandfather, really, we talked about him. The school bus, the kids, we talked about the school bus that we have now, you can get on, the kids make fun about calling the cheese wagon and all that stuff like that. But if they just realized how far they came from. But it was just a pickup truck with a homemade camper on the back with seats on the inside, built-in seat. And he charged, I think, about 25 cents a week for the kids to come up here. But they were able to come to Douglasville. Other than that, there were no place, you know, to go. There was no running water, that old big red pump. Once you pump down on that thing, look like a half a gallon of water came out at one spurt. And that was another privilege of being able to go out and pump water. If you're the pumper for that particular class. And we got a break, you know, you'd have a break. And you get a chance to go out there, but everybody brought their own glass. And for some reason, everybody knew their own glass and their own coat, because in that little room back there was a nail on the wall. And each person had a nail on the wall, and you put your coat on your nail. You didn't bother about putting it on anybody else's nail. We shared. And the glasses, you kept your glasses in there. When we got ready to go for water, you took your glass and you held it on the pump, and you got your glass and you drank, and you politely took your glass back, because your mom wasn't going to hear you bring the glasses, breaking a glass two or three times a week. So until they got smart and started bringing 10. And you believe it or not, some people are so poor until they use, you know, the cans that they use. They use that as a drinking utensil. But it was still water. This little school, like I say, brings back memories. It brings back words of gratitude, because if it had not been for persistent people like we have in the school system, who defy the odds and fought the barriers of segregation and kept going and didn't let that stop us. And we would not be able to sit here today and reminisce over things that are pleasant to us. And I say to any visiting students or kids, it didn't look quite this good. It wasn't this shiny. It wasn't this. The floors were very rough, and the walls wasn't this smooth and what have you. But I'm just grateful that you've done a tremendous job of restoring it and preserving it and keeping it up. And when I brought my aunt by here about 3 months ago, I just happened to come up down the stage, drove through here. I was thinking she knew, about this and had seen it. And I drove, and she called me Lewis. What is this? What is this, Lewis? I said, don't you know? And I said, what? She said, this is where your mother and father spent all that time trying to get us through school. She said, what do you mean, get? I said, that is the Little Red School. What Little Red School? I said, the Little Red School that your mother taught in down there in Bromley. And she got out and she read the sign on the door and she started crying, And she walked around it and she just rubbed it and everything. And she said, I'd like to see inside. But we couldn't get inside. So, Sam was glad to bring her up here the next day. He brought her up here the next day, and he not only did he bring in here, but he took over in the office and introduced some of his former co-workers and the superintendent and she was just impressed of the people that were working here and how much things had changed.
Children today can have no idea of what school was like in 1921 unless they experience it. The Little Red Schoolhouse educational project has grasped a vision to provide experiences for children so that by actually living a school day in 1921, they can not only learn to appreciate our education today, but appreciate the vision that people had in 1921 and to place a value on their education. The Little Red Schoolhouse provides field trips for children who come to spend a day in a 1921 classroom. The retired teachers are volunteers who dress as school marms and schoolmasters and teach the children so many wonderful things about the day that they have in 1921. The Retired Teachers Association, under the leadership of Andrew Schotten, has arranged for this immeasurable experience for children.
The Baldwin County Retirees Association is pleased to facilitate this outstanding, ongoing educational experience so that children in Baldwin County can have a chance to know what it was like to go to school in the 1920s in rural Baldwin County. The children come to the Little Red Schoolhouse and they experience life like it was in the good old days. They have a 3-hour living history project. And when they leave, they have a deeper understanding of education values and the way life was in a simpler time. We chose 1921 for this project, because that was the year that this building was first constructed. The children come and they try to reenact the first day of school just like it would have been in 1921. The teachers do the lesson plans, and they are dressed in period costume. When they arrive, they are greeted by volunteers, and they go through a brief orientation. And here they learn about how it is to sleep under heavy quilts, get up and go to the outhouse, grooming techniques, how it is to pump that pump to get water so they can wash their face. And many of them have so many chores to do before they even go to school. These volunteers share many, many memories with these students. And they get to learn, too, about what it was like to live in Baldwin County without electricity. Then they pretend that they're going to the Little Red Schoolhouse. They are barefoot, and they go through the fields, and they go through the woods, and they arrive at the Little Red Schoolhouse. And they're greeted by the school marm, ringing that bell.
Good morning.
She invites
them
to come in
to
get warm.
You may go in.
By the fire.
Good morning. Welcome to school.
Children are asked to share at the end of the class different things they really enjoy.
Is for carry.
They write down
and
that
the
they
word is
enjoy
school.
The spelling bee, playing those old-fashioned games outside during recess. They enjoyed writing on the slate boards. And most of all, they enjoyed sitting on the dunce stool.
So
and also learning about all those different chores that students
citizen.
Had to do back then. The students then are given an opportunity to make homemade toys to take home. The girls' corn shuck dolls and the boys' spinner buttons. The adults enjoy these activities as much as the children. Who says that learning can't be fun?
What we're going to do today, we're going to show you how to do a corn shuck doll. The corn shucks were something that you would have on the farm. And these people used everything they had. Isn't this a pretty little doll? All right, we're going to make it in segments. And ours won't be quite this elaborate. Ours will be a little bit simpler. First thing we're going to do is to take two corn shucks, or take a corn shuck. Doesn't really make that much difference. Fold it over like this. And then we need to tie a knot right around here. Tie a string right around there. And if you need to, we can get somebody else to hold it while you tie it, the person behind you. All these loose strings we can cut off later. They're not a problem, so don't worry about those. All right, now take one, tear it in two. Put it together. This is going to be our arms. Take the arms and put them in between the parts of the neck. And then we're going to tie them right here. So we are making her waist.
Does everyone have their string through their button and they're holding it equal distance at each end? Slide that up a bit. You got yours? Okay. We're going to take our hands, both hands turning like this. Got it going? Now, we're going to pull very gently, very gently. Okay. Try again. Try again.
We feel that it's so important for these children to learn these different activities and to have these experiences, which will be etched in their memories forever. And it is important for them to know about what it was like to go to school 87 years ago. The Little Red Schoolhouse Project is so important, and we're so thankful for those who had the vision and the hard work to make it become a reality.
A schoolmarm in 1921 was quite a bit different than our teachers today. As our volunteers have to learn in order to do a true reenactment of a 1921 school day with children. We learn about the morning activities, which did include Bible readings and prayer. We learn that the flag salute was different in 1921. We learn that the sources of income of the families and the livelihood of the teacher was different than it is today. And by becoming a 1921 school marm, the teachers are enriched as well. Well, you came in so nicely, boys and girls, for your very first day in the Little Red Schoolhouse. I like the way you're standing appropriately, and because this is our first day, we're going to learn what we do every day when you come to school. You will stand just like this, and when I come to the front of the room and see that everyone is standing properly, I will say, "Good morning, students," and you will say, "Good morning, teacher." Good morning, students.
Good morning, teacher.
You may be seated. And anytime you are seated, you fold your hands on top of your desk and pay close attention to the teacher. I am the school marm. My name is Mrs. Outlaw, but you can call me teacher. And every day, the very first thing we will do when we come to school is we will read what is on the board. Now, I know that some of you have never been to school, and some of you are old enough to be eighth graders, but we don't know if you can read or not, because this is your very first time in a real school. So what we are going to do today is do some things that will help me find out what grade you will be in. But I know we have first graders on this side of the room, and we have some second graders and all the way up to eighth graders on this side of the room. The first thing that we will do every day when you come in is that we will read what is written on the chalkboard, on our blackboard. So would you help me read that today? Good morning. Welcome to the Little Red Schoolhouse. And boys and girls, today is January the 31st, 1921. And we are celebrating a very special day. This day is the day that we have finally moved into this wonderful building that your parents built. I know that Will's dad had just been in a war, and when he came back, he talked all of the other daddies in this neighborhood into building this beautiful building. And we are excited to get to have a real education. Every day when we come to school, the first thing that we will do in our morning activities is that we will have someone read a Bible verse. Until I know who will be reading our Bible verse every day, until I learn who can read, we will have a thought for the day on the board. And today, let's read our thought for the day. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That's wonderful. I think some of you can read already. Every day after we have our devotion for the morning, we will do something that our new president, President Harding, has asked us to do. When Will's dad came back from the war, he brought this wonderful flag. And it is a flag of the United States of America. That's the name of our country. And it is just unbelievable that we have this beautiful map here that is of all the continents. I couldn't believe we have this wonderful map in our classroom. And the United States of America is right this part in the center. And does anyone know how many states are in America in 1921, this year? Yes, Christopher? 48 states are in the United States of America. And the flag that Will's dad brought back has 48 stars. And we are going to pledge allegiance to that flag of the United States of America in order to show that we appreciate our country and we will be faithful to the United States of America. Boys and girls, would you now stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag in 1921. Put your right hand over your heart. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. You may be seated. In our school lessons, we will do the three R's every day. We will do our lessons. And I see you've already seen your wonderful blackboard that you have on your desk, your slate, and we will be using that slate. We're so fortunate to have that. We will have reading, writing, and arithmetic every single day. But there are some things we have to learn about before we can do our lessons. Every day, many of us have to have chores to keep our beautiful room in wonderful condition. And every day, we will have people who will do things for us. The first thing that we will do that has to be done every day is that Christopher, would you stand and come up here with me, please? Boys and girls, Christopher has agreed to come in early every day and light our wood stove. His dad is going to be very sure that our wood box is filled every week. And on Friday afternoons, we'll let you boys go in the woods and gather some sticks so that maybe they won't have quite so much to do. Another thing that we have to do every day is to be very sure that the room is clean. Now, you know, I don't have a house to live in, and I've just moved here, and I want you to know that I'm staying at Sarah Beth's home. Sarah Beth, would you come forward for a few minutes and let everyone know that Sarah Beth has, her family has been so wonderful to let me stay with them. Sarah Beth's let me have her mattress. It's stuffed with corn shucks, and it's the nicest mattress. And she's sleeping on a pallet on the floor in front of the fireplace. And I thank you so much. And because I'm staying with her, every morning when you're walking to school barefoot across the fields and through the woods and across the creek, Sarah Beth's going to ride in the buggy with me to school every morning. So you're fortunate to get to ride in my buggy. When we do that, that means she gets to school early, and she's going to help me keep the room, get the room all ready for you. Sarah Beth, every day when you come in, this is the, turn around, there you go. I want everyone to see this wonderful broom that Sarah Beth's mother made for us, too. Now, Sarah Beth, every day you're going to have to come in and sweep this floor good for us, so if you'll show everyone, in case they ever get a turn to sweep, they'll know how to sweep the floor. Okay, and come back to the front. Good. Thank you so much, Sarah Beth. Many of you brought a lunch to school today, but I do want to tell you that because it's the first day of school, Stephen's dad brought us a special treat. He brought us each some potatoes. Do you know we grow red potatoes in Baldwin County a lot? So, Stephen, I'm going to let you go around and hand everybody a potato. or you carry the pot, and they'll each reach in and get one out. And when you get your potato, you can take your pencil and carve your initials in that potato. So you can be busy doing that. Carve your initials nice and big in that potato. And after the initials are carved in it, we can put it in a pot of water on the stove. And when it's time for lunch, you'll have a nice warm potato to eat for lunch on these cold days. That's a special treat. Now, boys and girls, one lesson that we have every day is penmanship. And in penmanship, it means we're going to learn to write our letters the very best that we can. And you see we have an alphabet chart here with our cursive writing that you older children will be learning. And you older children will also be learning to write with a quill to start with before you get a real pen. So you need to bring a feather from home, and you boys sharpen it with your knives to make a point on it, to make a nib. And you will have some ink. When you come in, there will be ink in the inkwell on your desk. Now, 5th through 8th graders will get to use the pen. And I want you to be very, very careful, because I know that the girls, your hair is so nice and long, but boys that are sitting behind the girls, even if those pigtails are bothering you, I do not want those pigtails to go down in this ink. Do you understand that? Because if you do something like that, you may have to find out about the hickory stick. School days, dear old golden rule days. Reading and writing and arithmetic talk to the tune of a hickory stick. Ladies and gentlemen, I will have to tell you that I do have a hickory stick in this classroom. And I hope that I do not have to use this hickory stick on any of you. If you talk when you are not supposed to be talking, I might just have to tap you right on the head with it. And if it's really, really annoying, or if you have talked back to the teacher, I may have to bring you right to the front of the room and use the hickory stick right on you, right there. And if you get a whooping at school, what do you think will happen when you get home?
You'll get a whooping at home.
You're probably going to get a whooping at home too. So, boys and girls, I don't ever want to have to use the hickory stick in this wonderful classroom. When we have our penmanship lesson every day, we will mostly write on your blackboards that you have. Now, your blackboards are painted wood, and that's what most blackboards in most schoolrooms are. Many blackboards, they just have to paint black paint right on the walls. We're very fortunate to have this slate board here so that we can have a real blackboard in your room. Your desk has a slate, and our penmanship lesson today is to write the golden rule. Now, if you can use printing, you may print. If you know how to do cursive yet, you may do cursive. I want you to copy the golden rule onto your slate using either printing or cursive, and I'm going to be watching you to see what kind of writing you can do, what penmanship you have. And one day, we may get to have some real paper to write on and use pencils and paper. So for your penmanship lesson today, I would like for you to be writing that. And while you are doing that, I will be calling different grades to the recitation bench to have your lesson and your reading lesson for your grade level. Boys and girls, every day when we have reading lesson, you will come to the recitation bench with your grade. and I will have your reading lesson with your grade and give you your test up here and your assignment, and then you will go back to your seat. Now, of course, the rest of you will be able to hear what the sixth graders are doing today in their reading lesson, and you may learn some things that you will love to hear. Also, when it's your turn to come, you be sure that you have your lessons ready to show me. Today I'm going to begin with the sixth graders, and we are using McGuffey's Reader.
One day, in order to have some fun, he cried out with all his might, "The wolf is coming, the wolf is coming."
Very good. I think you sixth graders have done an excellent job preparing for school. Thank you. You may very quietly stand up and go back to your seats. Boys and girls, it's now time for arithmetic. And we'll do some ciphering today. We have two people who will go to the board to do it on the board, and the rest of us will do our arithmetic on our slates. So, girls, would you please go to the board? We're taking some of our oldest girls to go to the board today. And for our arithmetic problem today, for our ciphering, you are going to be writing the number sentence for what I am going to show you with our potatoes. We love potatoes in Baldwin County. One day, we have potatoes to eat at school, and we're putting them in the pot. And first of all, we had three girls come and put potatoes in. One, two, three. So write down the numeral that shows how many potatoes I just put in the pot. Oh, pupils, I am so proud of your work that you're doing. You're doing your ciphering, your arithmetic. Oh, dear. Boys and girls, look at me. We have one student in our classroom who thinks that you're supposed to come to school and sleep. I want you to learn a lesson from this. Young man, you wake up. I want you to stand up here. How dare you sleep in my classroom? Turn around so this class can see you, and you come right up here. How in the world do you think you're going to learn your lessons if you do not pay attention? Your parents do not want you to sleep at school. Do you know what will happen if you do not do your lessons at school? You will grow up to be a dunce. And to remind you of that, I want you to sit on this dunce stool, and we're going to wear this dunce hat. And you should be ashamed of yourself, because you must do your lessons so you will grow up to be smart and be a fine, fine citizen. Boys and girls, I want you to look at this young man and remember what will happen if you do not do your lessons at school. You will grow up to be a dunce, and we want you to grow up to be a fine, upstanding citizen. The spelling bee was a favorite activity of all children of all ages. The same words were given to all children regardless of their grade level, and many times the spelling bee was held on a Friday afternoon, and many times parents came to watch the spelling bee. Boys and girls, it is Friday afternoon, time for our weekly spelling bee, and you know that the rules for the spelling bee are that I will call the word, you will say the word, then you will spell the word, and then you will say it again. And if you miss the word, then you will go to the end of the line. And today, Carrie is at the very first of the line, so Carrie has our first word today. And the first word is school.
S-C-H-O-O-L, school.
At the end of the Living History Day, in the 1921 setting, the children experience a culminating activity that helps to bring everything together into today. The schoolmarm first has the children imagine ways that school might be different in the future. So a child in 1921 would be imagining what school would be like in 2008. And when the children list those things that today are commonplace in our schools, it helps them realize how very far our education system has come since 1921. And as they look around their fellow classmates, they realize that in the ways that school was different in 1921, have built the schools that we are today. Those children became the adults that made life better for the next generation. And by encouraging these children to have a dream for the future, to make changes for the better, children can embrace our heritage and become people who make a difference in the world.
America.